Yes, so can you see my screen?
Yep.
Okay, so thank you for the invitation. I'm glad to speak to this workshop. So today I will present some work which is more than 1 year old, which might sound a bit ancient in the time scale of machine learning research. But I think this fits well the topic of today's workshop, and you will see a lot of connections with some topics that you have seen so far. And so I will present joint work with Francis Back about the implicit regularization of gradient descent when training two-layer neural networks. So we consider a classification task in this talk. So this means that the input variables X are in R to the D, and D might be is just the space of input like images or sounds, and the outputs Y are minus one, one, because we are doing a classification task. And the goal, of course, is to have a predictor that predicts the correct sign of Y given n IID samples from the training set. So to do that, we will consider in this talk wide two-layer ReLU neural networks. So this consists in the function class, which is written here. We consider predictors, which are the sum of simple functions, phi of wj x, where each of these functions, this simple function phi, are a simple ReLU function. So they are the composition of an affine function of their input, then a nonlinearity, which is the rectified linear unit, and then again, a multiplication by a scalar. So each of these simple functions has parameters A and B, which are the input and the output weights, which I stack in the vector W, and they will be the training parameters. So here in this way, in the way I've written the predictor, we see that we have a sum of our m simple functions, and there is the scaling 1 over m, which will be useful because we will consider the limit when the neural network has a large width, which means that m goes to plus infinity, and the scaling will be useful to obtain a non-degenerate limit. And here I've written the equations for the rectified linear unit, but more generally, our analysis could apply in the cases where phi is too homogeneous in the parameter W. So this is really a crucial assumption in what I will present, which is that when I multiply the parameters by some scalar R, then the output is multiplied by R squared. And this is due to the fact that in the ReLU neural networks, when I multiply both A and B by R, then I get R squared in the output. So this is the class of function, the class of predictors that I will consider. And now we will need to consider the training algorithm, which will be used to select these weights wj. And for that, we will consider the gradient flow and the empirical risk. So first, we consider a loss, which will be monotonously decreasing and exponentially tailed. So this is an assumption that covers, for instance, the logistic loss or the exponential loss. And then we consider the unregularized empirical risk for this loss, which is simply the sum of the losses over all the training sets. And since we will consider very wide neural networks, in fact, in their infinite infinite width limit, there will be many minimizers to this empirical risk. In fact, if you just take any predictor which predicts the correct sign on all the training sets and multiply its magnitude by some scalar R, then you can make this empirical risk go arbitrarily close to zero, thanks to the loss, the tail of the loss. And so it will be useful and necessary to study the training dynamics to understand which minimizer is selected by the algorithm. So that's the standard topic of understanding the implicit regularization of training algorithms. And in this talk, we'll consider a very simple situation where we consider the gradient flow of this empirical risk. So this means that we will initialize all the weights independently according to some distribution on the space of parameters. This means I have the distributions for the input weights and another distribution for the output weights. This distribution will be the probability distribution on the space of parameters. And then I will just consider the gradient flow of this empirical risk up to some normalization. And the idea is that we want to this is an idealization of various gradient-based learning algorithms that we would like to understand. So let me show you an illustration of such dynamics. So here I will show a video of the training dynamics of wide two-layer neural networks in a simple two-dimensional classification task. So on the left, this is the parameter space, and I plot for each neuron the product of the input weights times the absolute magnitude of the output weight. So since here we are d equals to 2, the parameters live in R to the 4, and so this representation is used to see a dynamics in R to the 3, and then the color red or blue will depend on the sign of B. And here this is the space of predictor with the pluses and the minuses, which are the training sets, and the line will be the decision boundary. So here is the training dynamics of the gradient descent for this loss. So we consider a finite training set. And here in the space of parameters, the unit sphere is at infinity, because in fact, all the neurons, their weights will go to plus infinity. So I've rescaled the radial axis. And what we observe is that the neurons, they cluster into a few groups of weights. Although at initialization, there were a lot of neurons, in the end, we only observe a few clusters. And in predictor space, this corresponds to a predictor with a few edges, which is a polygonal decision boundary. So the question we would like to understand is, what's the performance of the predictor we have learned after the training dynamics? And I will give some hints towards these questions, but no full answer, of course, in this talk. And first, let me give you an inspiration and where the idea of R-analysis comes from. And it comes from the results of implicit regularization for simple linear classifiers. So here I will recall a result by Soudry and co-authors, which deals with a predictor, which is not just an affine predictor, parameterized by a weight W. And they show that if the training set is linearly separable, then whatever the initialization, they show that the gradient flow of the empirical risk will diverge to plus infinity. But if now we renormalize the weights, and look at the direction, then they show that in direction, these weights, they converge to a L2 max margin classifier. And of course, since we are interested in classification, only the direction of the classifier matters. So it is not really, it's not an issue that the weights diverge to plus infinity, but in the end, we converge to an L2 max margin classifier, which is a specific classifier for which generalization properties can be analyzed. So now let me show. So now we will show a similar results, but for wide two-layer neural networks. And to state the result, we need some background on the function spaces associated to neural network. And that's very convenient because Theodore in his talk has just introduced all these spaces. So I will just recall these spaces and adapt the notations. So this is really the same definitions as in Theodore's talk. If you have a predictor H, you will define its F2 norm as follows. So you try to decompose H as a linear combination of rich functions, of ReLU functions, with weights G of A. And you find over all such decompositions, the one with the smallest L2 norm. This gives you a norm, which is a norm associated to a reproducible kernel Hilbert space. And it's often called the conjugate RKHS for neural networks. And now we can also define this different norm on the space of predictors, where we place the L2 norm by the L1 norm when we try to find the somehow the sparsest decomposition. At least L1 norm, it's known that it has some sparsifying effect. So we've tried to find the sparse decomposition of our predictor H over this dictionary of ReLU-like functions. And to recall briefly what we have learned from Theodore's talk is that roughly this F2 norm, it will favor functions which are isotropically smooth, while F1 norm, it can potentially be small even for functions which are not really smooth, as long as they are non-smooth in just a few directions. So F1 can be adaptative to anisotropy in the predictor that we want to learn. So this, it was just a brief recall of the function space associated to neural network. And now let me state the main result that we have with Francis in this paper. So assume that at initialization, the input weights are uniform on the sphere. And the output weights are uniform on -1, 1. So here, this is just to fix ideas. I give a specific initialization scheme. But for instance, the absolute scale of the initialization does not matter with the result I will present. Now, we do not need to assume any linear separability assumption because two-layer neural networks are universal approximators. So we just need to assume that the training set is consistent, that there exists a function that interpolates on the training set. And there will be some additional technical assumptions, which unfortunately I do not have the time to discuss here, but they are quite important. We need to assume several objects converge in the infinite width dynamics to make the result rigorous. But under these assumptions, we show that the predictor learned by gradient descent in the infinite width limit and the infinite time limit will converge to a F1 max margin classifier. So this corresponds in equation to the following fact that when you take the limits in time and in infinite width, so in fact here the limits can be interchanged in M and T, then the margin of our predictor will be the max margin over the F1 norm space. All right, so here there are some, let me comment a little bit on these results. So first on the downside, it is really a qualitative result. There's nothing quantitative. We do not know how large T or how large M needs to be. And in fact, there are some hints, like we know that there are some hard problems that can be incorporated as F1 max margin problems. So we know that there will be some situations where these limits will be very difficult to observe. We need a very large number of neurons and a very large training time, but it gives us at least a qualitative feel of what kind of function is learned by a wide neural network. And that's a function, at least, that asymptotically will approach this F1 max margin classifier. So, and to give a contrast with what happens when we only train the output layer of the neural network, then we recover the random feature setting that was presented by Theodore. And in that case, by just applying the previous results of Soudry and Cotter, we can show that it is to the F2 max margin classifier. So we have these two types of behavior when we train both layers or just the output layer of a two-layer ReLU neural network. So let me show you some illustrations. So here the illustrations are in a similar setting as in Maria's talk. We consider a classification task with two classes and in dimension 15, but only the first two coordinates are relevant to perform the classification and all the remaining 13 coordinates will be just pure noise. So for this training set, first here I plot the margin as a function of M. M is the number of neurons in my neural network. And this is the F1 margin. So our result says that asymptotically when M increases, we will converge to the F1 max margin. And in this specific example, we observe that 100 neurons are sufficient to converge to the F1 max margin. But of course, this is just a specific example. And in general, I do not expect this result to be so efficient. But in some settings, this limit, this asymptotic regime, can be achieved quite rapidly, apparently. And now, when we look at the test error as a function of the number of samples, so here we compare the test error when training both layers, which is this F1 max margin classifier, and only the output layer, which is this kernel max margin classifier, this kernel SVM. And we see that after 500 samples, we already have almost perfect generalization with this F1 max margin classifier, while the kernel method still makes a lot of mistakes. And this can be understood by some arguments that we have seen in the previous talks. But in the specific setting of classification task, we have shown a small statistical bound which confirms this numerical experiment. So here, this is a statistical bound that uses classical margin classification theory, margin-based generalization bounds. So let me present it. We assume that the inputs are almost surely bounded and that there exists some smaller dimension, which I will call R, such that after a projection of rank R, the two classes with pluses and minus one, they can be separated by at least a distance delta of R. And this is the test on the test distribution. So we assume that the two classes are well separated after a prediction of rank R. So this is precisely the setting of the previous experiment where we had a two-dimensional projection for which the two classes could be separated. And then we show that the proportion of mistakes for the F1 max margin classifier, it is bounded by the following quantity. So we have a certain decrease as a function of the number of samples seen, and which is multiplied by some quantity, which depends on the difficulty of the task. So it depends on how close the two classes are. But what's crucial here is that there is no dependency, no explicit dependency in the dimension D. So these are dimension independent bounds. So in practice, the dimension can intervene into R, but at least it does not intervene into the exponent. So that's another appearance of the good adaptivity property of this F1 max margin classifier related to two-layer neural networks. So now, okay, I have 1 minute. I can maybe give one last comment. So everything that I've presented so far was non-quantitative in terms of optimization time. And in fact, when we look at the literature about implicit regularization of gradient methods for exponentially tailed losses, there are very few quantitative results when we go beyond the setting of linear predictors, which are parameterized linearly. And here, we want to understand a little bit more precisely what is the behavior of these dynamics that we have with two-layer neural networks. And although we cannot so far give training time guarantees for this, the results that I've presented, we can look at simplified situations. So in particular, we have looked at the specific situation when we train both layers, but we fix the direction on the input weights. And in that case, we could show a convergence in a certain rate of convergence by making an analogy between this, the behavior of gradient descent and online mirror descent. So I will not go into the detail for this result. Let me just comment that as it was seen in Theodore Stoke, that F1 cannot be approximated when we fix the directions. It cannot be well approximated with fixed directions. So this result, of course, does not solve the optimization in F1 space, but at least it gives us a little bit some hints about what can happen when we discretize the time axis. And making the main theorem quantitative is fully open. So since my time is over, I will conclude for this talk and emphasize again that the main open question is to find interesting assumptions under which we can make the main theorem quantitative. So this is a fully open problem. And also it could be interesting to deal with more complex architectures in the future. Thank you for your attention.